The Lunar Cult was the ancient cult of moon worship. Moon worship was the basis of one of the oldest and most widespread cults of the ancient world. There's not a great deal of information about this cult, probably because it was eventually superseded by the later cult of the sun or the solar cult. There is some evidence carved on a clay tablet that records that King Sargon of Babylonia about 3000 BC ordered the reformation of the calendar to make the year begin with the entry of the sun into the zodiacal sign of Taurus at the spring equinox. So we know that by that time, the cult of the moon had already begun to decline in importance and was being challenged by the solar cult. However, moon worshippers did continue to build temples to her in her honor, even after the sun became the central figure of religious systems in the ancient world. As a matter of fact, probably aspects of the lunar cult became grafted onto the solar cult, and the two became fused together, even after the sun became the dominant figure. Both sun and moon motifs are found in the earliest recorded myths. Why did ancient people worship the moon? From earliest times, people believed that the moon exercised a strong and controlling influence on all life, plant and animal alike. These influences were seen to be both favorable and unfavorable. In her favorable aspects, the moon was thought to influence the raising of crops and animals, fecundity, childbirth, weather, and even commerce. On the other hand, the moon was thought to be a cause of sterility, fevers, and diseases, especially of women. The terms lunacy and lunatic, used to describe a person who is mentally ill or crazy, comes from the term luna, which is the name for the moon. The ancients thus believed that the moon was able to influence the health and well-being of people in many areas. Primitive people made a connection between phases of the moon and certain phenomena on Earth, leading to the belief that the moon had caused these to come about. Of course, they had no scientific explanation for these happenings, so they turned to a supernatural explanation. And that explanation was that the moon had supernatural powers, and thus the moon was personified. Thus, the moon became a deity. This is because the ancients noticed that there was a connection between the 28-day cycle of the moon, changes of the moon and ocean tides, and the menstrual cycle of women. Because of this, they believed the moon controlled and regulated the cycle of life. The moon was named the Great Regulator, and the people thought that it not only regulated their lives but controlled them. They were also very aware of the changes of the moon and thought these had a decisive influence on existence as well. The day of the full moon was called Shabbatu in ancient Sumeria and was described as the day of the heart, the day when the heart of the god is appeased. No work was done on these days, and the people held celebrations. Later, Shabbatu came to mark the four quarters of the moon, the 7th, 14th, 21st, and 28th days of the month were celebrated as well. No work was done on these days. Eventually, the Hebrews adopted a 7-day week along with the measurement of solar time, and previous to this, time was measured in lunar time. The word for moon in Latin is mensis, from which we get our word menstruation. In India, the moon is min or manu, in Sanskrit, mas, in Persian, ma, in German, mand, in Dutch, man, in Mexico, metzel, in Greek, minos, and in Egyptian, min. There are many old sayings, beliefs, and superstitions found in ancient cultures the world over that relate to the generative powers of the moon. Here are just a few of them. Conception was regulated by the moon. The full moon was considered the best time to hold a marriage ceremony. A male child should be weaned when the horn moon is waxing and a female when it is waning. The hair is cut only at the change of the moon in order to make sure it does not grow back too quickly. Some women do not comb their hair at certain stages of the moon. Weeds cut in the dark phase of the moon will not come up again. According to Reverend Timothy Harley in his book Moon Lore, the time of the full moon was chosen in both Mexico and Peru to celebrate festivals for water deities, patronesses of agriculture, and generally the ceremonies connected with the crops that were regulated by the phases of the moon. Other stories about moon-related superstitions are related in the book Symbols, Sex, and the Stars by Ernest Busenbark. These are only a few of the many he cites in the book. In some parts of England, superstitious people consider it disrespectful or sinful to point at the moon. In some cultures, women curtsy to the moon, make cakes in her honor, and men take their hats off to her. The Japanese sacred festivals are held at certain seasons of the year and at changes of the moon. In Iceland, it was believed that if a pregnant woman sits with her face toward the moon, her child will be a lunatic. In Greenland, girls avoid looking too long at the moon for fear of becoming pregnant. The hunting tribes of Mexico would not sleep in the moonlight or leave their game exposed to it either. In Scotland, it was believed if a child was taken from the breast during the waning of the moon, it would decay during the time the moon wanes. The site of ancient Babylon, which is modern-day Iraq, has yielded many clay tablets that indicate the Sumerians paid great homage to a great triad of gods. The city of Ur was originally on or near the Persian Gulf, and from the earliest time, Ur was the center of moon worship. In early Sumerian records, the name of the moon god is Nannar, who ruled with the goddess called Ningal or Nana. As the Sumerian cities became dominated by the Semitic culture of Babylon, the influence of Sin, the moon god of Ur, became greater and more widespread not only in Babylonia, but in other parts of the ancient world. It was only in Babylon, however, where Semitic influence was strong, that Sin was particularly honored as father of the gods. Sin was represented as an old man with a long beard seated beneath the crescent moon. He was identified with the healing arts and as governor of oracles and dreams. On the other hand, he had a sinister aspect as a bringer of sickness and misfortune to mortals and could punish evildoers with leprosy. Texts exalt him as the governor of light and wisdom. His titles designate him as the wanderer, the living father, uncle, or the old one. The goddess of fertility was extremely important to the ancient moon worshippers. In very early myths, the goddess Ishtar is represented as the daughter of Enlil or Bel, the earth god. Very early in Babylonian history, she appears as the great central figure who dominates the whole scene, just as in later centuries, the central figure is the sun. Under many forms and titles, she's the goddess associated with the earth, the great mother goddess who gives birth to everything. The earth was esteemed as the womb from which all life came, and the moon was honored as the generator of life by giving forces that gave birth, growth, decay, and death of all plant and animal life, and by regulating these. Ishtar, the moon goddess, rose out of the sea, her name probably signifying the star which seemed to rise from the ocean. One of the main reasons the moon was associated with growth is that the lowering of the temperature of the night causes moisture in the air to condense and form dew, which nourishes vegetation and causes growth. In both mythology and astrology, the moon is associated with humidity, moisture, water, and femininity, whereas the sun is considered dry, hot, and masculine. Ishtar was ruler of the generative powers of nature. She absorbed the attributes of many other goddesses after the conquest of Babylon by Assyria. She then began to be portrayed also as a goddess of war and destruction. She came near to becoming the main deity, even over Sin, the moon god. She was Ishtar, the moon goddess, the queen of heaven. There's a great amount of lunar folklore found all over the world that shows that many people still believe in some of the superstitions about the moon that the Babylonians believed more than 5,000 years ago. Ishtar's lunar characteristics are continually revealed in Babylonian mythology and sculpture. She's often shown seated or standing with her bosom bared and a suckling infant at her breast. At her feet or overhead is a crescent moon with seven bright stars. The Indian Devaki, Egyptian Isis, and the Christian Virgin Mary were all portrayed this same way. During the time of the lunar cult, we find the first attempt to depict the mother goddess in human form. This illustrates the importance of women in the lunar cult. The father was not symbolized until the solar cult, which of course came after the lunar cult. During the time of the stellar cult, the great mother had been portrayed as a tree, or cow, or sow, or hippopotamus. This, as a matter of fact, is where the expression holy cow comes from, and probably where the Hindu idea that cows are sacred comes from as well. The attempts to portray the Great Mother in human form took two shapes, and they come from every place the Lunar Cult people traveled: Europe, parts of Asia, South America, and Africa. Both of these types were taken from the pygmies. The ancient Egyptians knew the pygmy was the first human that evolved, and that the first depiction was the female type, a mother. The figures they shaped represented Hathor, the moon goddess, and her child Horus. The Great Mother, who was earlier symbolized as a cow with her child Horus as a calf or bull. The custom of applying the term virgin to the mother goddesses may be traced back to the period when they were more specifically identified with the moon. The moon goddess passed down the centuries as the Great Mother goddess, who created and ruled all life on earth, yet was never a bride. In Egypt, she was known as Isis, in India as Devaki, in Phrygia as Artemis, in Carthage she was Tanit, in China, Ching Man. In Syria, she appeared as half-human and half-fish under the name of Attar or Athar. In Lebanon, her name was Atargatis. She had traits in common with Demeter, with Hecate as goddess of the moon, and with Rhea, goddess of the earth. Her name varied in different times and places, but her character remained essentially the same. A distinctive feature of the mother goddesses is their frequent identification with names derived from the root ma, which in Greek means mother or nurse. Following the supremacy of the lunar cult came the solar cult. It was named the solar cult because the ancient people of this cult had found that time was not accurately recorded by the moon, so they changed their method and began keeping time by the sun.